My economics teacher back then always taught me something. It is very difficult to separate politics from economics. And as I grow up, I am beginning to really understand what he meant when he said those words. Truly, you cannot separate politics from economics. As such, economics affect our day-to-day life, and we attempted to talk about the economic status quo of the nation. As such, in so doing, we tend to also view the political status in the country. Though there might be different views politically, we are really tempted to do so. And as responsible citizens, we must delve into those information. Hello, guys. Thank you for joining me once again today. Please don't forget to subscribe and also to subscribe for notifications so that you won't miss any of the videos that we post here. My name is Honorable Madiva and the channel is DMAP Steven. So our first story today is that of a roundup of the elections, of the by-elections that happened over the weekend. The by-elections, a by-elections happens when an office incumbent cannot finish his or her term due to reasons beyond his or her control. So they stem from effects like the arrest of a member of parliament or a councillor, the death of a member of parliament or a councillor, or even serious illness that might render them inadequate to serve the duty of a public office. So the by-election of the weekend took place in two places, one Kuadzana and the other in Mwenezi. Kuadzana is a MDC stronghold, so it was an MDC affair. And then Mwenezi also was a ZANU-PF seat, which stemmed after MDC Alliance could not field a candidate, so the seat was uncontested. But even though the results which we obtained from Mwenezi indicate that it was better for MDC to not field in a candidate once again because it performed dismally. So MDC in Mwenezi had approximately 1,811 votes against, ZANU-PF had 1,811 votes against 27 for MDC. So it comes back to to what the MDC has been crying about all along. They have been crying that the rural vote is being rigged. Why? Because of vote buying, because of the abuse of traditional chiefs, because of vote rigging, and so forth. They have got many reasons. Voter intimidation, vote buying stems through food starvation of opposition political supporters. So there are many things, but the sad thing is that even the MDC do not have a solution of how they are going to deal with such a dilemma they are facing. So as usual, the secretary for elections in the MDC, Mr. Jacob Mafume, informed ZEC of the irregularities pertaining both the by-elections, where we could see political commissars in ZANU-PF, the likes of Matema Danda, donating food. So they cited those issues, saying that it was vote buying. Then ZEC said it could not handle criminal offenses since it is the duty of the police. So ZEC instructed them to inform the police, which they said they would. They would inform the police of the criminal offense. We don't know whether it will work to their favor or it is one of those circus which just happens. It's ZEC, police, ZEC and stuff. So the MDC is challenged now to find solutions. I recall Honorable Chikombo, an MP in the MDC, who is also a chairman of the Harare province, once said that it's time the MDC engage in an eye for an eye in ZANU-PF. Maybe where they donate food, MDC must donate as well, and maybe that will work. We don't know. It was one of his proposals, but the a certain permanent secretary thinks otherwise. Nick Mangwana thinks otherwise. He thinks that this is how MDC is defeated, even in presidential elections, in watershed elections. Because looking at the vote totals in KwaZana, ZANU PF had 718 votes and MDC had approximately 1519, which means that if you add the total of MDC votes, it was something like 1544 against 2529 for ZANU PF. So Nick Mangwana was saying MDC loses because of the fact that in rural areas ZANU PF wins overwhelmingly, and then come to urban areas the MDC stronghold. MDC wins marginally, the gap is slight. So that is the reason he didn't comment on other allegations as purported by the MDC. So it remains in the MDC for them to see what will work for them so that they may avoid such a dilemma come 2023. Corrupt cartels here in Zimbabwe. The issue of cartels was brought forward by Louis Matutu and one Godfrey Zenengamo, being ZANU PF, should I say, ex-members, because they have been suspended from the Politburo. So this is what happened. They did a name and shame in which they mentioned some big names in the private sector, including Tafatswa Musarara, the chairman of the Grain Millers Association, and Kudata Gwirei of the Sakunda fame, and also Billy Rutenberg. So they accused the trio of capturing the state through monopolizing every industry in which they venture in. And so the issue of cartels seems not to have to be ending soon, as the prosecutor general in an interview on Star FM also highlighted the existence of such, to the extent that people were threatening him that he will soon be referred to the Chitepo School of Ideology, like what happened to Matutu and Tseningamu. So the prosecutor general, Mr. Hozi, said that it will be difficult for the cartels era to end in Zimbabwe, since these cartels do not only control the government, but they are said to also control the judiciary, to also control the police, to also control each and every state institution, including the Zimbabwe Anti-Corruption Commission and also the media in Zimbabwe. So it's like a web which cannot end soon. So as the citizens of Zimbabwe, we do not really know now whether this cartel will end, because if the prosecutor says they will not end, is a sad story, because the prosecutor is supposed to be the one who will hold those accountable for their actions. And Tsenegamu emphasized that he have got very strong evidence of the trio and their corrupt activities. We now don't know what evidence he holds against them, but for him to say he has got evidence, the evidence must really be incriminating. So we just wait and see whether he will produce the evidence which is sufficient to prosecute the trio who are alleged to be very corrupt. So the other allegations are linked to the Command Agriculture Scheme, which is supposed to be a scheme where farmers are financed so that they may produce for the grain marketing board. I know of quite a lot of people who benefited from Command Agriculture through farming inputs. So I don't know whether it's in it a total demon or part of it has been penetrated. So it is said that Tagwirei and Musarara are using this scheme to loot from state coffers. This also comes when Tendai Biti and his public accounts committee tried to question. There were so many unanswered questions on this scheme called Command Agriculture. So the recent issue that is alluded by Hopo Chingono through his Twitter post is that there is no mention of the end of the deal, in which many videos have surfaced in which His Excellency the President of Zimbabwe is seen with Tafadzwa Musarara. Tafadzwa Musarara had promised to buy 800,000 metric tons from local farmers. So for him to buy that as an individual, and the president was really yappy about it. So probably they done their cost benefit analysis and saw it fit to afford Tafadzwa Musarara such a deal. We don't know the evil around the deal, but what we know for a fact is if these are really running a corrupt cartel, the corrupt cartels must end and end soon for the betterment of the Zimbabweans, for the betterment of everyone, for the betterment even of the country at large, because right now things are really not well. We want to, in itself, the scheme was supposed to retain Zimbabwe as a food basket of Southern Africa, as previously was the situation. But now we are facing drought and drought each and every season. So we hope that ultimately Command Agriculture will be of the greater benefit to the general population. I thank you for your time. I thank you for listening up to the end. Please don't forget to subscribe, like, and share. Also, comment with your feedback. We value your support. We value your feedback. We value your time. Thank you so much. Yepy Valentine's.